Avi, we would like to hear from Jaideep as to his critical views on the presentation and generally on the social and policy environment. Jaideep, please.
I would ask Ajay to help me to get this done across.
You can even speak in mixing it with Telugu.
I don't know.
We also have a Telugu audience here. Then mix it up.
Alok wants me to also mix up with Telugu. Many may be not comfortable or many are comfortable. Yeah, fine. Then we'll go in English. Then Ajay will help me. It's a fantastic study which gives a broad picture to the entire development sector as well as to the policy environment in this country. I'm referring to this study into the context of India itself, and especially to the context of Andhra Pradesh. I've gone through all the documents of this particular project. It's a voluminous of information which is generated, and the volume of time again, you need to quantify it, and that is invested to do a analysis in depth. The questionnaire itself is about more than 150 pages. I think one would take a huge time to invest it with one child and family and the community is enormous. I wouldn't have that much patience to respond. For me, it takes at least 3 days to answer all these questions. That kind of information. And also, it's a longitudinal process. That is what is needed today, is to track the change process, what's happening in the lives of the children and the families who have been excluded, and or rather we are not being included into the systemic change process. I would go with the kind of response is with respect to the social, political, environmental, and the entire economic domain of change. With respect to these outcomes within round one and round two, it's called from 2002 and 2006, is quite interesting. In both these locations, they have tried to understand from differential perspectives with respect to these five areas, which are clearly laid out. But what is structurally looked at is there is a huge discriminative process which is very, very significantly underlying still or lying underneath in the change. In the domain, though we looked at of tracking change, but still it is quite rampant in nature. Even today, when you generalize in the particular context of eight select districts or six select districts in the state of Andhra Pradesh, cutting across three agro-geographical regions per se. But what interests is even if I go with the case of Mahbub Nagar and of my recent visit, it's also. It says that the child is still denied opportunities. The child is still being discriminated not to come near the school. Forget about coming into the class. Not to come to the school because you are from an excluded community. You do not have the right to be part of this school process. And if the study also says the kind of things that are happening, it's in front of our eyes with the last decade and a half or 3 decades and a half where much efforts have been done by the government in terms of addressing these discriminatory issues, but it is not, it is still challenging to us. And study also is very significantly throwing up light. In some points it is encouraging, some points it is pulling. Some of the factors which are pulling down, because it is some of the drought-prone districts in the state and which is have a negative impact on the economic conditions. Still, it is a startling reality that not much of change is happening in those people's lives over there. Why I'm saying this is, if you look at the girl-child enrollment rate in Mahbub Nagar district, I'm just going case by case, and in trying to understand from a child and a parent's point of view, and looking at all these parameters what Ajay has been stating off, is in terms of looking at the health itself. And Mahbub Nagar is one of the most drought-prone states in the history of Andhra Pradesh, and which the migration is quite rampant over a period of time. And people who are staying in the villages have relative opportunities, and people who have migrated are denied of all the opportunities. That is what the access and control to resources which been talked of earlier by many. Here is, these are the kinds of groups which are being left out and which are not considered. If you look at their health status, it is quite precarious. Most of the migrants are living in literally in vulnerabilities. Having touched those vulnerable families, which I could not find out details on those aspects in the study itself. That is one limitation probably for the study to track the kind of migrant families and to look at the dimensions with respect to health, education, and the entire socio-political and other well-being analysis. And the stereotyping is which quietly stronger in nature. And though we talk about girl child, but the girl child is never been part of the work, which is good or bad, which I don't know. When we talk about the issue of child labor, when the boy child can go for work and the girl child is deprived to go to work because of the entire stereotyping process. Though we say that child labor is to be abolished, but still these kind of things continue to practice in front of ourselves. But we do not respect the families who live in that reality when state services fail. In the context of NREGS, especially I go by only one district, Mahabubnagar, have been left out with the nutritional security support, quote unquote, the midday meal scheme. Where are these kinds of groups which are tracked in this process? Have been, if the focus was also on the issues of children who are working, and have we also tracked them? Because I could not find some data with respect to that. There is a limitation. We need to respect that limitations in the study also. How are we doing on this? Where is the nutritional security coming in? If you are talking about nutritional security, it has a correlation to the child's well-being. The child's well-being is connected to, again, to be part of the school or not to be part of the school again. These are all contextualized to the situation, position, and condition of those children with respect to boys and girls again. And it is also connected to the mother and father again. These are the interplaying things which are not clearly laid out, because study design probably conceived about 10 years ago, which almost trickled down and down to doing it to 2009, has almost all the limitations which are respectable and acceptable again. And the feel good factor which I see from this study is something what the voices of children of those being studied, if probably that of either by parents or in terms of on the emotional aspects by the grandparents or the other relatives in the family who tend to understand the levels of education these children do require. But this has never become a focus, and the administration also did not put into a focus. And these are the larger issues which are emerging now. Now, how are we going to track this? Whether it, do we do it in 2009 or 2011? If I'm 11 or 12, then 12. Are we these? If there is any opportunity of having the questionnaire to be open-ended into the next phase, I think we need to strengthen those areas. Going by the whole incidence of poverty again, I would see here is not childhood poverty, but it is child's poverty again and the family poverty. There are three sets of things which we are saying. Child by natural process has all the rights and entitlements and the what all is said under the CRC process has to be protected. But we look at child's poverty per se, when we are looking at some of the conditions of children, especially who are being denied opportunities in terms of developing their own skill set resource itself. When we are looking at the age category of 10 to 15 children, when we do into the next process of study again, what is the transformation that would happen in that particular child of study reference of today? Are there any skill sets looked at when we look at childhood skills again, and which we say in terms of childhood skills acquisition? These are the larger set of things which very strongly emerges before us. We look at the psychosocial dimension among families, especially with the Dalit families and especially with the tribal families and the most backward families and the most religiously excluded families again. This is very serious issue. And the last part of it, no one tend to focus on much more on the religious minorities itself, who have been denied opportunities. The study reference which I draw up also is not except as a few sample households being covered under the religious minorities, if I am clear on that. And we need to reverse this pyramid of questions to be probed in courts, that actually who comes first itself, not who is the last person, but who is the first person we need to talk to. That kind of a thing probably need to be altered in the next probing process. In terms of people which we are talking about, innate abilities with reference to the cognitive development, when we look at, I take a cue from the studies which have been done and also the personal experience of the children itself. There is a very interesting and which touched me itself, why children do not want to go to school, and especially with the Dalit children itself. And I got to a feeling, and I thought this is something beyond exclusion which we normally see before us because of caste-based discrimination, but it's something beyond itself. This is a Tamil Nadu case. I am still into probe into Andhra Pradesh also. I narrate the same instance of a Dalit family which is in a normative context, is more similar in the context of India in terms of the emotional state of well-being that the particular Dalit families live with. This very boy in Tamil Nadu who do not want to go to school, it's not that the child is being discriminated based on caste itself, but he is denied the opportunity to play in the school itself, play in the community itself. The only one thing which aspires them is that I also would like to play cricket like any other. My parents cannot buy me a bat. Even the bat which I play is not that kind of comfort which it is. What is the point of living when I am denied opportunity to play with others in the society and denied opportunities to play in the school because of the inabilities and the socio-economic conditions that the families live with, and to help these children to live with? This is the emotional state which drew up me, that it's just very small thing. Children play cricket. It's 7-8 years old, children play cricket within their own community or the particular socialization process that they have in the peer neighborhood. Still they are being denied even to play with a stick to hit a ball. It is the worst condition which we are living with. This is the worst condition. Forget about the in-school process. If the only stick to play with, you are denied. And I have friends here who have done extreme studies on the issues of untouchability and the many, many studies which probe on the caste-based discriminations. This is worse, actually, which not to hold a stick to hit a ball. Where do these children live with? And Tamil Nadu is one of the best progressive states on affirmative policies. But still, if you look at in Andhra Pradesh, if I go back to each village and hamlets and habitations of Dalit communities, things will be much worse. And Mahbub Nagar, which we are going to do an in-depth analysis on the caste-based discrimination in schools with reference to children with disabilities. You imagine that is what Alok set off in the multiple degrees of marginalization. This is not one form of doubly marginalizing. It is multiple marginalization processes happening, which my recent encounter with one family is, I don't have answers. It is a shame on my face, actually, which is in congruence with this study, which says that people, Dalit families, are feeding toddy to make their children sleep. So if they get up, they feel hungry and ask for food. And the great NRGA is working in Mahbub Nagar district. And the families have to live with them. This is what the health study, which I am also looking at, is how we track these families, such families. Can we look at such kind of distress conditions and the prevailing hunger? which is not visible hunger itself, because it's not food insecurity. Food is available to everyone, but it is the entire way of discrimination which is being they are facing with, and this is how they are treating those families. And it is clearly said to the government also. I'm not shying away to say that. And it is told. But no action is initiated till date in terms of addressing those distressed needs of those families. The issue very interestingly touched me is the hunger part in schools, which is being addressed as the midday meal scheme. In Mahbub Nagar district, you don't have the child going to school because child are put to sleep because you get up to ask for food. And where do they go to school and ask for midday meal? Yeah, I think I can open up some of these questions.